Good morning. Welcome to the Lord's house this morning for our last Sunday of 2020. Hard to believe we're here, but also I'm glad to be here. So I pray that you have had a good holiday. I pray that you got to spend it with your loved ones, your family, with those who are special to you. And I pray that nothing intruded on it too much, but it was truly a blessing to you. And I pray that as we have this last week, you'll be able to enjoy this last week as well. We are heading into a new year, and we just all pray, God, please bless us and keep us in even greater ways in this new year than this last year. Because I have said many negative things about this year, but I do believe God has taught us how to be stronger, how to have more considerate of one another, and to take nothing for granted. So if He's taught us, then it's a good year. If it's drawn us closer to Him, then it's a good year. If we've learned to love a little better, then even in the midst of it all, it's still a good year. So let's give Him thanks. Let me ask you to stand. We'll go to the Lord in prayer, and as you can, give Him thanks for what He's done in your life. Give Him thanks for the things that He has done for you, and with anticipation. Claim some things for the new year. God, I give it to you, and Lord, I pray that it will be truly a good year. Father, we open this service up with thanksgiving to you. Dear God, I'm glad we can still celebrate that Jesus has come. Lord Jesus, 1 week after your birth, you're still the Savior of the world. Even when the shepherds didn't show up or the angels sing in the sky, the Savior was still amongst us. It would take several years before the wise men would come by. But they would know the truth that was true every day of your life. The King of the world walked on this planet. And your Father, He not just walked and not just lived and died, but He's risen again. And to this day and time, He is the Lord of His church. He's the Lord of our hearts. But you're still also the Lord and King of this world. So Father, I pray that what we have seen in this year, both the good and the bad, will reinforce that we're not in control, nor is any man, woman, or child who says they are. May we realize there is power higher than we are. There is a purpose greater than our purpose. And Father, may we realize that our best way of living life is to surrender, to give ourselves to you, and your Heavenly Father to accept your will for us. So Father, I pray your blessings on the congregation this morning. I pray your blessings as they end this year. I pray your blessings as they begin a new year. Father, I pray that in and through them, the light of Jesus Christ will come. We need you. We need you not just for viruses. We need you for sin sickness, for darkness, for depression, for oppression and addiction, dear God. All kinds of things that have been part of our daily lives. But Lord Jesus, you still set us free too. So we don't just bow, we surrender. We lower our hearts in reverence to you and say, oh God, have your way. And so, Father, I pray that as we do that, your presence will be drawn nearer. And we'll know this is holy ground. It's a holy hour. And dear Father, we praise your name in it. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I wonder why this is up here. The pretty people back here don't get it. The good people. But we praise God to be here this morning. During this season, I've realized more that to God be the glory, great things He has done. Let's sing 2 or 3 verses of that, sister, then. Praise God. To God be the glory.
Lord, praise the Lord.
It's always good and appropriate to praise the Lord. He is good to us, and His blessings are always there. Always, always there. We want to go back to the Lord in prayer and take the needs of the body. But there's always, in time of need, there's always blessing. Like the blessings of birthdays. Miss Peggy Brown today. We won't ask her, but she's older. She's still alive and kicking pretty doggone good. So praise the Lord for that. She's a blessing not only to her family, but to this church. I also want to say I talked to Steve Howard last night. He is tremendously better. He has now been released from the hospital. He said, "Preacher, I won't be able to make it tomorrow, but I can't wait to be back in church next Sunday. I can't wait." So that is the anticipation. He says, God has been good to me. He's a man who suffered greatly, but he says, God has been good to me. So if he can say that, boy, I can today. I can say that. Thanks be to God. So we're glad for that progress. We do want to remember, of course, Jamie Carson's family. That funeral will be tomorrow at First Mount Moriah. So let's do remember that family and pray for them. Also remember Jacob Chapman and his family. He lost his grandfather this week, and they'll be burying him today. So please lift them up in prayer. You may know others that have had a loss here recent times. It's here. It's still here. But we don't look for an absence of problems, but we know God's grace is present within our problems. Also don't remember Tina Carr and her family caught in hospice for her grandmother. So difficult time for them as well. Call the family in for her grandmother, so let's do remember them. Any other requests you would like to mention?
Amen. Thank you, Father.
Before we sing again, I do want to highlight that we are beginning a new year, and we have gotten into the habit, many of you, of reading the Bible through in a year. I have some Bible reading guides out there for you. We'll speak a little bit more about that next week as we actually get into the new year. But if you want to go ahead and get started, they are back there for you. And I pray that God encourages you in that. I believe we need His Word. And that was one of the praises yesterday. Not for family and not for food, but praise for the Word of God. I still think we need the truth today. This year has been marked by truths mixed with lies to the point where we say, what do you believe anymore? Yeah. Well, let me tell you, believe the Word of God. Trust in the Word of God. It has not failed those who have trusted in it. It will not fail us either. So may God bless you in your reading in 2021.
Let's stand together again. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Sing to your God and Lord this morning. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee.
What a wonderful name that is. The name of Jesus. You think it doesn't make a difference? It still makes a difference. In our still political climate, I saw it. I'm not going to get political here, but maybe you saw a graphic of you know, our clearly very divided country, at least in worldview. And one commentator, I'm not sure if they were on the more liberal or conservative side, but they said, let's break up the union into two different parties, all of North America, all from California up through Canada, all the way through New York. We'll make that the North America or whatever, something like that. And the rest of it, of all things, from coast to coast, from all the way, Arizona, all the way up to Virginia, they call Jesus Land. Now, of all things to call them, that's what they chose. Because evidently that name carries weight from coast to coast. And the only problem that I saw with that commentary is that some of those in northern Michigan said, oh no, you ain't leaving us up here with these crazy people. We'd rather come down to Jesus Land. So there's a hunger for that name and the truth that name represents. So praise God. Praise God. Jesus still carries weight in this world. I'm thankful that we are going to see that demonstrated once again by our young people. I am proud of Connor, Ben, Lindsay, our youth board, and our youth for presenting something. I tell you, it got them excited. They get a little excited when they get to do something, and I'm glad of that. There ought to be some excitement about serving Jesus. We ought not be dull and bored out of our minds serving Jesus. If we're not excited about it and pushing it on the edge, we're not doing it right. Because it is a life-changing, constantly life-giving thing. So I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Connor and let him introduce it. But let's all just have our hearts and minds open as they present to us this message.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just want to elaborate a little bit on what he said. They truly have been very excited for this. These last few weeks, we have been very limited on our time. And we were really rushing, trying to get things prepared. But every week when they come to practice, they put in as much effort as they possibly can. They hold each other accountable. And I'm very, very proud of what they've done these last few weeks. We had our last practice last night. And I cut it short because I was amazed at how good they were doing with this amount of time that they've had. So without further ado, I would like to the youth group to introduce y'all, Mary DeGina.
your baby boy is Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know? The
change the world. Jesus says, I have my church. That's who I designed to change the world. And change the world we have, and change the world we intended to do so. Let's turn our attention to the Word of God now. We're going to look at John chapter 17 today. I appreciate all your attention. We've been talking about all the roads lead home to Jesus. I'm going to ask the God says if they will come and read for us today. And I'll ask you to please stand as they come.
My prayer is not for the world, but for those you have given me, because they belong to you. All who are mine belong to you, and you have given them to me, so they bring me glory. Now I am departing from this world. They are staying in this world, but I am coming to you, Holy Father. You have given me your name. Now protect them by the power of your name, so that they will be united just as we are.
During my time here, I protected them by the power of the name you gave me. I guarded them so that no one was lost except the one headed for destruction, as the scriptures foretold. Now I am coming to you. I told them many things while I was with them in this world, so they will be filled with my joy. I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world.
I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth.
Just as you sent me into this world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. I am not praying only for these disciples, but also for all those who will ever believe in me through their message.
I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one, as you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, so they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. Father, I want these whom you have given me to be with me where I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you loved me even before the world began. O righteous Father, the world doesn't know you, but I do. And these disciples know you sent me. I have revealed you to them, and I will continue to do so. Then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them.
You may be seated. Part of coming home to family, we look at the meals, we look at the activities and all that we do together, but we always have a special activity that perhaps you do as well. When the meal is done, when our devotions and our sharing is finally complete, it's not quite finished until we squeeze everybody into a small space and we get somebody to move back as far as they can and take a family picture. That just kind of sums up the event. After that, you can go and do what you want to, play, leave, whatever. But a family picture is a part of the celebration. It's a part of saying, this is our family. Yeah, we had one last year, but that's not this year. And if you're like my family, some people that were there last year are not there this year, and some here this year that weren't there last year. So you've got to have a picture because we just feel if you're here, you belong. That's just how we feel. We don't check to see if your last name fits. We don't check to see if we were talking about some of the former girlfriends and boyfriends that we brought that are not there anymore. Didn't matter. They were welcome for that day. They were part of it that day. And even one of them said, "My ex-girlfriend still missed this family gathering." can't help that one. But also I wanted to remind the younger members of our family that you think everybody that's older we've got it all together. No, it's been a struggle. It's been a stress. It wasn't all perfect. But because God is faithful to our family, half of this room is in this room right now. God is good. But a family picture says something else too. It says you belong here. You're here with us. You are meant to be here. And as I was thinking about that in Jesus and thinking about how home is really where Jesus is, living in Him, which is exactly what Jesus is talking about in this passage, not being American, not being a world-type people, but being the people of God. That means something. It should mean something to us, but I'm going to say it certainly means something to God. Jesus says, I'm not of this world. And He's not just talking about that I'm not from this planet. He means I don't belong to this worldly frame of reference. I'm not simply sinful humanity. I'm from another place. But I love that passage where He says, they are not of this world either. Right. Now, Peter, he acted like he was of this world at times. So did John. So did all the disciples. But because they were with Jesus, and because Jesus had embraced them, He's talking to His Father and says, they don't belong to this world any more than I do. So in that moment, if Jesus wanted to take a family picture, He would have included this group. He would have included the disciples. Very much imperfect, but they're still His. I think that's a beautiful expression. I love the expression that's made similarly. If Jesus had a refrigerator, you'd be on it. If He had a wallet, all your pictures would fill it. If Jesus had a bookshelf, you would be the ornaments that are all in front of the books. That's because Jesus loves you. We say that, but a lot of times we lose the impact of that. He truly does. It has always been that way. God pays attention to you. The Scriptures tell us this over and over. He came to save the world, the people in the world. And I don't know anybody here that's been born on the moon, though I think He'd cover you too. You were born here. He came here. And when He says, whosoever believe, like that old song, whosoever surely means me. It surely means you. That's He made it open-ended for all of us. He made man in His image. He not only knows the stars by name, He knows you by name. Amen. He chose the weak, the small, the overlooked, the forgotten to be His heroes and champions throughout all of history as an example. Here's what I do. I don't look for the strong. I look for the willing. And He uses them again and again. He answers prayer like Jabez, who got like, what, two whole verses in the whole Bible? What's that doing in there? You might appreciate it because you're going through all the chronologies. You're glad for a break every once in a while, but it's just two verses. God knew His name, and God heard His prayer. That speaks volumes to me. I don't know Jabez. I wouldn't know him if you put a picture in front of me. God knew him. God heard his prayer, and God answered his prayer. And he's basically a nobody. But to God, he was worth listening to and worth answering. He knows the hair on everyone's head. He cares about one boy's lunch. And he thinks we're worth more attention than the birds of the air and the flowers of the field. God loves the world, but don't miss, He cares about you. Oh, He's overlooking me for other people. No, don't believe that lie. God has invited you into His family picture, and God wants you to be a part of all that He's doing. Now, let me tell you about this from John chapter 17. This is a beautiful passage. I love to reference this time and time again because here's Jesus. He's not praying over a meal. He's not praying over the sick. He's praying about His followers and all they're going to face and all the struggles and all the strains and then the ones coming down through history. So I love to refer to this as the prayer of all disciples because He was praying for you. He was praying for me. Those who are going to believe through in my name through them, that's me. That's you. It's made it through the time and the distance from that point to us. Anybody been to the Billy Graham Library? Is that all? Boy, we need to take a trip. It's a wonderful thing. But one beautiful display is not about all the other things about his ministry. And by the way, if you ever go, I'm not showing you that pulpit. I'm not telling you why, but I'm not showing you that pulpit. He had a very specially made pulpit, and it was not just for him either. But as I was saying, as he comes through the end of the museum there, you see a wall that has all these different faces and all these different names. And what it was, it's this person reached this person, and this person reached this person, and this person went to this one's revival, and through that revival, this one was touched, and eventually, this one led Billy Graham to Jesus Christ, and then Billy Graham got above before the world, and he reached millions for Christ. It just simply showed in a small microcosm, the gospel went to the disciples, and then it made it all the way to you. Where was the place you heard it? Where was the person that you heard it spoken through? It may not have been a person. It may have been on TV. It may have been on the radio. It could have been anywhere. But God got the message to you. Why? Because He feels like you belong in this family. You belong in this family picture. And He thinks of you in that way. He says three things in this passage that I want you to remember today. Number one, that He's a giver. He wants you to know about Him, how He treats you. He's a giver. In this passage, He says He gave them the Word of God. In other words, He gave them truth. He didn't give them a book. A book wasn't written at that time. They just had the Old Testament scrolls. He gave them the Word of God, the truth, out of His mouth. What He spoke, what He shared, it was the truth of God that would help their lives. He gave them what they needed to live. That's an important thing. There's many things I may fail at teaching my kids, but one thing I want to not fail in is to tell them the truth. Absolutely, 100% the truth. Whether they listen, whether they have to one day say, oh, well, Mom and Daddy were right. They wouldn't be the first because, you know, hello, I've done it too. But I guess my mama was right, more right than I thought she was. That's because when you're committed to the truth, even when it hurts, even when it makes you look bad, you tell the truth. Because that's what truly helps. We're living by too many lies today. Too many people believe in too many lies, and it's causing chaos in our world. We need to stop it. And if it costs us dearly to speak the truth, then by God's grace, let's speak the truth and not be ashamed of it. That's what Jesus did. Because that's the greatest gift you can give. He not only gave us the word, he gave us a lot of graces along the way. Peter needed a few. John needed a few. Thomas needed some extra even after he's risen from the dead. That's all right. He gave it. He gave the graces that they need. And can I tell you, he's given me plenty of graces. He's also given me spiritual gifts. How about you? As I read the scriptures, he says that when he ascended up on high, he gave gifts to men. Now, what disturbs me is not that Jesus didn't fill the spiritual Christmas tree with a bunch of gifts. The problem I see is there's a bunch of gifts that are still unwrapped under there. There's a bunch of people that still say, I've got enough of Christ. Oh, hallelujah. If you got enough, let me assure you today, you don't. Because until he blows your mind, until he puts you on your knees, until you can't think you can stand another moment of his presence because it's the greatest, most powerful thing you have ever felt in your life, until all the lies waste away and you're bawling before him saying, God, I'm thankful for your love. No, you don't have enough of Jesus, but I can tell you, he's given you all you can stand and yet more. He gave his church because he loves us. Has not expired, has not been worn out. He has given it to us. We watched Silas the other day, is he 2 yet? He's 2. Well, at 2-year-old, I remember 2-year-olds. They're more fascinated with the outside than they are the inside of stuff. And so he wasn't really concerned about the gifts for a while. He wanted to get that paper off. Every piece of paper. I mean, we're ready for him to open the stuff. Just open the thing. So we could get to the point. But all he wanted to do is rip off that paper slowly and methodically, hand it to his dad. And I was like, just come on, just get on with it. And I get a little weary with us. We just want to play with the paper. But the gift is there. And if you don't feel close to God, then you're just catching up with him. He already wants you close to him. If you're distant, if you don't feel power in your life, he's wanting to pull you aside so that you will. God loves to give you graces and gifts. Don't get caught up in the trappings that you miss the present. Henry Scougal said it this way. God has long contended with a stubborn world and thrown down many a blessing upon them. And when all his other gifts could not prevail, he at last made a gift of himself. Is Jesus going with you in 2021? Oh, come on now. Is Jesus going with you in 2021? Amen. You need him. Telling you the truth. You need him. We're all thinking, oh, the 2020 is going to be over. And I'm thinking, what does the date mean? I mean, what has ever changed about January the 1st? We've made a lot of promises, and we've broken a lot of promises. Oh, it's going to be different this year. Just to find it's the same old, same old. A date don't make a difference, but I can tell you, Jesus Christ applied to my life makes a tremendous difference. Take the gift. It belongs to you. Number one, number two, I love what he says in here that he is, I think he said a guardian, he's a protector. Also says he kept them. Now that is a beautiful word that I think we missed. They were hanging around with Jesus. They were walking with him. They were guarding him. You remember that story where they're pushing everybody away? No, you can't get near Jesus. You can't get near. Children, just get out of the way. Get out of the way. Jesus didn't want to be guarded. He wanted the people to come to him. So they thought they were in charge of Jesus. They didn't realize Jesus reveals in this prayer, I was holding on to them. I was protecting them. I was keeping them. I was guarding them. They didn't know that. How could they be so oblivious? I guess the same way I am. I think I'm doing so much for Jesus. I don't realize how much he's doing for me. I think I'm making it on my own. And then all of a sudden, I have some near accident or something happened I don't expect. And I say, thank you, God, for watching me and protecting me. And I'm glad he doesn't speak to me. Where you think I've been every other day? What you think I've been doing every other hour? What you think I've done since before you were ever born? I knew you. I planned for you. And I have kept you by my own name. You know it sometimes, but it happens all the time. Yes. That's because He's a keeper. He guards us. He holds us with Himself. Now, I can imagine that those that thought themselves of His disciples the greatest, they would take some time before they would understand that. But God and Jesus was patient. Long-suffering, even, with them. With their weaknesses, with their failures, because they would fail time and time and time and time again. And a bad thing about church is sometimes we get to sitting on the judge's chair. And we get to start looking at people and say, you've messed up too much. You don't belong here anymore. You're lesser now. You don't really belong here anymore. Well, nobody elected you judge. And nobody's given you that authority. God is the one that saves, and God is the one that keeps. We are here to encourage, we're here to uplift, and yes, if there's serious doctrinal issues, yes, they must be upheld and lines must be drawn. But it is God who says, I am the judge. It is Jesus who said, I didn't come to this world at this moment in time to judge them, but I did come to save them. So if we're not in the saving business, we're not in the Jesus business. Because that's what He's all about. He's about keeping. He's about guarding. And that takes patience. That takes time. God keeps. Do we kick out our families that don't hold the family line? Of course not. Do we say you don't belong anymore? Of course not. We love our family. God loves you more than you understand. God loves those fallen more than you understand. And I want to thank all of you who haven't given up praying when you've prayed for the same person, the same prayer, 10, 20, 100 plus times. Thank God for that, because you're believing in a God that is greater than what you see and is greater than what you understand. As my mom already shared, I could not believe that we spent over an hour yesterday in my family, talking about what God has done in our family. And it wasn't they all came to one church and they all heard it together. They all have their individual stories, but the common theme was Jesus has made a difference in my life. We talked about a lot of things for hours. We wasted a whole lot of time on football, a whole lot of time on non-essential things. That was an extreme blessing. Prayer and patience shows God knows how to keep those who are His own. But let me end by saying, God's also a planner. How did Jesus end this prayer, this very intimate prayer about saying the interaction between God and man? These words should be highlighted in your Bible. I want them to be where I am.
Yes, amen.
I want them to know what I know. I know what they know now. I know about life. I know about struggles. I know about strains. I know about sin. I've had to bear the sins of these people day in and day out. The ramifications, and He will bear the sin of the world. But He wants them to be with Him. That means He wants a better future for you and for me than our past. Anybody want to go back to their past? I know I don't. I want to go something better in front of me. Jesus has planned exactly for that. He wants you to know knowledge you've never known. He wants you to know wisdom that's greater than all human wisdom. He wants you to know love, excitement, beauty, and satisfaction that you've never experienced before. He wants you to know that, but that's not here. It can't be here. So something's got to happen between here and there to get us to there so that we will know what He knows. Greatest blessing that can ever be given. That's what He wants. But He's planned for that. Isn't it good to know God has a plan?
Yes.
I didn't know about 2020, but God did.
Yes, He did.
I didn't know all the struggle and the strain and the sorrow that this year was going to hold, but He did. Well, how do I know? What does that matter? I didn't know how to prepare, but He knew how to hold me. You didn't know how to prepare, but you've made it through because He knows how to hold you. He's got a plan. And can I say, things are working according to plan. Things are moving according to plan. But preacher, some people are harder against God. Still His plan. But I can also say, people are closer to God than they've ever been. See, the plan is not about what happens in the year. It's about the condition of our hearts. He's planning for something that is greater than we can understand, greater than we can ever see in this world. He wants to accept us. He wants us to feel, I belong in God's house. You ever been in somebody's house and you feel like, this is not like my house. I don't belong here. They put their furniture up different. Everything's really in place and everything is just so spread out. I don't feel comfortable here. How do we think we're going to be comfortable in heaven? We ever think about it? Heaven's not like here. It's not like your home. It's not like the church. It's not like anything you've ever experienced before. How are we going to be comfortable there? That's Jesus' plan. He's preparing us for what is to come. Ephesians 1:6 says, God has made us accepted. Say that with me. Accepted. Am I accepted? Yep. Got a scripture for you. Ephesians 1:6. I am accepted. That's God's plan. It's what He died for. It's what He bled for. That's what He suffered for. You are accepted, but it's in the Beloved. It's in Jesus. You are accepted in Jesus. So, what did He want? What is His plan? Overarching plan. Well, only got a few minutes left, so I better hurry up with this one. God planned to reach all the nations through Israel. It's always been His plan. You don't believe me? Let's have a study on that one time. Through the very beginning of the Bible, He intends to win the world through Israel. The problem is Israel ain't ready. Israel needs saving before Israel can share that with the world. So God had to reach Israel, but then God sent Jesus to do both. To reach Israel, but also to reach the world. And so when He did that, Jesus died that we might be saved. The gospel went out through His disciples to Jews and Gentiles alike. Impact was made. But even as we read those first chapters of Acts, the natural vine was pulled away so that an American, an African, and an Australian, and all types of Greeks, Romans, and Gentiles could be brought into that vine, and the vine accepted the branches. Do you understand me? I don't know how to make plants come together. I don't have that skill, but the vine was put together with the branch, and though it was not natural, it came together, and salvation flowed into the Gentile nations, and we begin to say, Jesus saves. We're accepted. That was His plan. He called it the times of the Gentiles. That means I'm on the clock, and so are you. Time is ticking. Connor, don't be mad. Time is ticking away. We better be ready for the times of the Gentiles, because the times of the Gentiles will end. And then Israel will come back to God. And then all things are really starting to change. What's happening in the meantime? Jesus said, I go away. While I go away, I'm going to be preparing. I'm going to be getting things ready. I'm going to be moving things, creating things. I'm going to be preparing a place for you. So He's not idle, and He's not saying, man, what am I going to do while the times of the Gentiles is coming? He's preparing for my place. He's preparing for your place, because our God is a creative God, and this stuff is just the rough draft. Let me tell you, the complete is coming. The final, beautiful existence that God has always wanted, it is coming, and I have a part, and all of you whose names is written in a book He's prepared for you, you are being prepared for in heaven. But I'm living right now, not with a place just being prepared for me, but He's preparing me for the place. So those two's going to come together, and the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. And He's not coming for the kings and the potentates. And most, if I read my Bible, most people's not even going to know it. They're going to go on about their life and say, what just happened? But you see, He knows every name. He's got a perfect GPS. He knows where you are, and He knows what you're doing. And it says in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, whatever you're doing, you're dropping. Whatever you're in, you're leaving. Whatever you've been a part of in that moment, it's gone. And you are with Him. so forever. That's the plan. How do you know that's the plan? Well, Paul shared that in Thessalonians. I read this in John 17. I want them to be where I am. And I want them to see the glory. I want them to know what it's like to be with you. What is it like to experience the Trinity? I don't know, but I'm going to find out. That's the plan. You're a part of that plan. Because in this family picture, you and I are a part. It's like a deprived child finally got adopted, brought into a rich family, and had his first Christmas. Can you imagine what would happen? He'd look around that tree and he'd see all those presents. And he'd say, who's that for? That's for you. All of that for me? Yes. That's what heaven's going to be like. When we get there and realize what he's been planning, I mean, all of that is for me.
Yes, amen.
Yes.
Praise God.
That's what God has longed for.
Thank you, Lord.
My favorite Christmas movie is It's a Wonderful Life. Watched it this year. Bawled like a baby. Always do. Not because I'm just sentimental. That is true. The older I get, the more sentimental I get. There's a message there. That is not accidental. It's a very religious movie, and I've read some of the background on it. A lot more than you think. A lot of deep spiritual truths went into that movie. If you'll remember, Jimmy Stewart having his really broken in the bar, and everything was falling apart. He prayed a prayer, one of the most intense parts of the entire movie. That prayer was 100% genuine. So was the slap in the drugstore, but that was a painful thing to think about. But that prayer was 100% genuine. Jimmy Stewart recounted later, when he's praying, Dear Father in heaven, show me the way. He said, as I said those words, I felt the loneliness and the hopelessness of people who had nowhere to turn. My eyes filled with tears. I broke down sobbing. It was not planned at all. But the power of that prayer. The realization that our Father in heaven is there to help the hopeless had reduced me to tears. So you watch that movie again and you realize every tear, every intense shaking of that moment of acting, it was felt very realistically. And you have to remember, I didn't realize this till I read, he had just come out of World War II. He was probably still struggling with post-traumatic stress syndrome. He was on edge, but he gave it. Not just acting, he gave it his heart. And actually, the original ending to that movie was, guess what? Jimmy Stewart reconciled back with his family, but on his knees, saying the Lord's Prayer. They decided not to do that one. And I love the ending, absolutely love the ending. But I think they should have incorporated his first idea with the last idea. Because finally saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That is a beautiful ending because life matters, because Jesus says your life matters. But then to show everyone coming together shows the other half that I think they were missing. And the final words about this character, you're the richest man in town. Exactly how Jesus wants you to feel. You're the richest person in this town. Among a rich congregation right here. And I'm not talking about your bank account. I could care less about your bank account. What I know right now is your bank account in heaven is quite full. And it is full of great treasures, but the best of it all is God says, I know your name, and you belong with me. Not eventually, you belong with me right now. Would you bow your heads? Church, as you end 2020, know God loves you. You belong. But God won't take you anyway. He takes you His way. He's opened a door for you. Don't try to crawl in through a window. He spread it wide. Jesus is that door. Don't think goodness, connections, or charity. I don't think any of those things is a substitute for being in the Beloved. And I realize I'm talking to this as somebody who may not know Jesus Christ. That's I always want to make that available. But I don't think that's exclusive to those who've not made that ultimate commitment. I think that's to Christians as well. Because your good works don't earn you one more thing in heaven. You can't do anything to earn your salvation because it's already been done. You may throw stuff on top, but it will never, ever equal what Jesus has done for you. You have to accept He takes me as I am. He cleanses me. He owns me. He wants to use me. And in that type of life, God will use you. God will bless through you. God has great things in store for you. And even as our body wastes away, the Bible says our spirit is being renewed by His power. So that when we're ready to leave this world, the body can't keep up. We've got to lay it down and we've got to take off. It was difficult seeing Miss Jamie Carson go from active and loving worship in the church to now being body laid in the ground just a few days. But I'm going to tell you what, her body couldn't hold it. Her spirit had to sail upward because somebody called her name. And that's the joy that I have in a difficult time of sharing about a saint, because the Bible says, blessed in the sight of God is the death of one of His saints. He calls them home. You've had enough. As good as it's been, it's not nearly good enough. He's calling us all home. Whether by rapture or the grave, church I plan to go. That's God's plan for me. I plan to take Him up on it. And I want you to as well. Because maybe you're discouraged. Maybe your faith has been dented. Or maybe it's in tatters. Doesn't matter. God is big enough, strong enough, and loving enough to say, don't move to the outskirts. Move a little closer. Stand with me.